Wow, what a start, huh? Man, powerful speakers. Well, thank you very much, and I know that this promises to be really an exciting afternoon. We're talking about something that is, you know, it's really wonkish, isn't it? Right? I mean, it's money, banking is really kind of wonkish, and it's actually an area that I've been interested in for a long time. My background is in tax and fiscal policy. I started that in the executive branch a long time ago. And continued that with the legislature and worked at the local level and state level for a long time. And one of the things that we have, that I've been concerned about for a very long time is our basic economic development model in the state doesn't seem to be working very well. But before I move on, I would like to give a shout out to City Council from Albuquerque today and Vips and Zane. Yeah. So, thank you for being here. Voices for Children do research and policy work on public policies that impact New Mexico's children and families. Much of that work involves health and education issues, but also includes tax policy as well as other policies that impact economic development and the economic environment here in the state. Fundamentally, like we believe that all New Mexico families deserve the opportunity to thrive, and if we create an economic environment of opportunity, some of the poor rankings and what we might call the misery statistics will improve and be addressed. However, when you look at almost any economic statistic, it's difficult to argue that the economic environment that exists today here in New Mexico, despite some of the political rhetoric we're hearing during the campaign season, is really working for us. Job growth has been anemic at best. We seem to be the hole in the donut, right? The surrounding states work their way out of the recession. According to U.S. Census Bureau, that we reported last week, New Mexico is just one of three states in which poverty worsened year over year. Income equality has been worsening. This is particularly troubling as voters become less inclined to participate and believe that the political and economic system are working for them. And much of this leads to a terrible ranking in child well-being. Last year, as you probably know, Annie Casey Foundation's Kids Count Report ranked us 50th last in the nation in child well-being. This year, we made great progress. We leapfrogged Mississippi, and now we're 49th. Woo-hoo! There's a root to that, right? Not so much. It's not working. Something's not working. And I want to thank Craig the Public Banking Institute, and we are people here and the others that have been involved in this discussion. It's really a great opportunity to have a really robust public policy discussion. And just on the side, this is the third day in a row I've been here in Santa Fe. On Thursday, I spoke at the Legislative Finance Committee talking about career pathways and how we need to do more of investing in people and infrastructure for economic development. Yesterday, I did an interview on a local radio station regarding something called social impact bonds, which we're going to have hopefully more discussion of over the next year. And then, of course, here today. So Santa Fe is really leading the charge in these really important public policy discussions. Well, we have an incredible panel this afternoon that will describe how our current financial situation, our system rather, addresses the needs of various communities in our state. We'll hear about Native American communities. We'll hear about immigrant and Hispanic communities and small business, among others. We'll hear about how local governments are struggling. I was a city manager for 9 years or so on two different occasions. And the money is difficult to come by for really basic services, and we'll hear more about that today. To start our panel, we've got one of Santa Fe's own. I want to make sure I get this file right. Joseph Miaskis represents District 2 on the Santa Fe City Council. He's a registered professional engineer right here in New Mexico and a supervisory civil engineer with the Bureau of Reclamation. He was the president of the New Mexico Municipal League Board of Directors, which is where I got to know him. He's vice chair of the Conservation Voters of New Mexico Board of Directors. He's chairman of the New Mexico Voices for Children, former chairman of the board, and former mayor of Espanola. He has a master's degree in civil engineering from UNM and a master's degree in civil engineering from Arizona State. Please help me welcome Pastor Joseph Meyer.
Thank you, James, and thank you, everyone, for being here this afternoon. I have the unenviable task to summarize infrastructure in 10 minutes and present a compelling case to consider alternative options for financing. So let's get going. And that's my topic. It's infrastructure and funding. I want to give you just a brief outline. I think when we hear the word infrastructure, I don't know what kind of feelings, if any, it exhibits in you. But I'm going to try and talk a little bit about the importance of infrastructure and give you a snapshot of the condition of infrastructure, not just at the national and statewide level, but at the local level. And I'm just going to present to you just some of the tried and true traditional funding sources that we use to fund infrastructure projects. And then I'm going to end with that compelling call to action. So let's get started here. So when you think about infrastructure, we really don't think about it until we have a catastrophe. If you look at that photo on the left, that's the Interstate 35 bridge over the Mississippi River in Minneapolis that collapsed. The highway system that Eisenhower built had a catastrophic collapse. 13 people lost their lives and 150 were injured. You look at the photo on the right. That was during Hurricane Katrina when one of the levees failed. And we all know what happened and how devastating that was. That picture in the middle, on the bottom there, is a water main break right here in Santa Fe in 2013. We lost 1 million gallons. However, the crater that the water main break created almost collapsed the natural gas line, and that would have been catastrophic. And that photo on the top is basically a deteriorated, dilapidated curb on the plaza. So we think about different things when we see infrastructure in this condition. Is it a matter of community pride? Do we wonder what our government's doing? Where are their priorities? This is basic. Well, hopefully you're going to find out how difficult and complex it is to fund a lot of these infrastructure issues. Okay, infrastructure, it's essential. It's essential to a vibrant community and improves our quality of life. It's really the kind of the foundation that connects all of us. And we all know about the economic impact in terms of personal income, in terms of long-term economic growth, gross domestic product, exports, and on and on. But the bottom line is, infrastructure is part of what makes our country great, and it is a source of our prosperity. This is just a quick front page. Every year, the American Society of Civil Engineers does an assessment of infrastructure across the country. And this is just the cover, and they issue a report card. So what does that report card entail? Right now, in 2013, the overall grade was a D+. What does that mean? It means our infrastructure is poor, it's at risk, it's below standard, it's approaching the end of its service life, and it has a strong risk of failure. And I'm going to show you just some numbers from this report, this national report. Keep in mind, these amounts are in billions, in 2010 billions, and this is a funding amount necessary to get us to a grade B, which is, okay, which is okay. Here you can see a lot of the different infrastructure funding categories, but the bottom line is the total needed right there, in all these systems, $1.6 trillion. That's the funding gap in funding all of these infrastructure systems. And of course, there's annual operating